Hello, this is Lazarus at telecomTech, where telecom and networking technologies are simply explained. Today, we'll be simply explaining the shortest path first algorithm used by OSPF. I've enabled the super thanks option for my videos. If you find them useful, like, subscribe, and send me a super thanks to support me in my effort to simply explain telecom and networking. Every super thanks is deeply appreciated. OSPF is what is known as a link state routing protocol, and it uses the shortest path first, or the SPF algorithm, to determine the shortest path to each destination. OSPF's SPF is based on a mathematical algorithm called Dijkstra's algorithm that was developed by Edgar Dijkstra, a pioneering Dutch computer scientist. He developed it way back in 1956. Then it was just a mathematical algorithm, but OSPF adopted the use of that algorithm to do its job. When I was learning about OSPF, no one taught me about this algorithm, and I had come to realize that this hindered my understanding of OSPF's operation. For this reason, in this video, we'll look at how Dijkstra's algorithm works in the context of OSPF, which I believe will give you insight and understanding when it comes to the operation of this routing protocol. But let's start with some definitions. This algorithm is a strictly mathematical process within the realm of what is known as graph theory. So we'll be using a mathematical construct called a graph. A graph is actually very similar to a network of routers. A mathematical graph looks like this. It's composed of vertices and edges. But because we're looking at this in the context of a network topology, we'll be using the terms routers and links. So this is our topology of OSPF routers, and these are our links. Each link has a particular cost assigned to it, and each router knows the cost of each of its own links. Now, the ultimate goal of Dijkstra's algorithm is to allow each of these routers to learn the shortest path, or the path with the lowest cost, to reach every other router in the topology. More accurately stated, the ultimate goal is to reach the directly connected networks of each of these routers. Those are our destinations, so those are the costs that we must measure. So from the point of view of router A, for example, the cost to reach router C is the same thing as the cost to reach any directly connected network to router C. This definition of the ultimate goal of the algorithm is the reason why we say that each router must create a map of the whole topology in OSPF, in contrast to distance vector routing protocols like EIGRP or RIP. So here is the topology that we'll be working with today, and here are the costs of each individual link. Now, we will go through the process of Dijkstra's algorithm step by step. Remember that this algorithm is run by each router individually. We will look at the process of this algorithm from the point of view of router A. But before we begin, we have to define a few of the things that we will be measuring. First, we must define a set of unvisited routers and a set of visited routers. At the beginning, all routers are unvisited. Every time we perform the algorithm at a specific router, that router will move from the unvisited set to the visited set. We also create this table here that indicates the cost, or the distance, to reach each router from our starting router A. At the beginning, since we're doing this from the point of view of A, the distance to router A is zero, and the distance to all other routers is essentially unknown. So we put a value of infinity for each of those. And finally, we have one more column here in this table that indicates the previous router, or the router via which we reached that specific router. If these definitions are not completely clear, not to worry. As we go through the process, it will become clear. Now, before we actually start the algorithm, I'd just like to say that the routers in this topology are able to go through this algorithm because of the information that they collect from all of the LSAs they receive from their neighbors. LSAs contain prefix information as well as topology information. And when we say topology information, we mean information about the links and the costs of those links. So from that received information via the LSAs, each router can build this table internally, and thus it can build the OSPF topology. So let's start the process. We start from the point of view of A, and we see that its distance is zero. Now from router A, we will examine, in order, every unvisited directly connected node. The algorithm starts by looking at how we get from A to the next unvisited router. And we'll start with router B. The cost to get there is 2. So we update the table accordingly. Now, one more piece of information we get here is the previous router. In this case, to get to router B with a cost of 2, we went via router A. So we put A in this column here. Now let's look at the second unvisited, directly connected router to A, and that is router D. From A to get to D, we have a cost of 8. So we put that in the table. And the previous router, or the router via which we get to D, is A. So we put that in the previous column as well. There are no more directly connected unvisited nodes to router A. So at this point, we can say that we've finished with router A. Router A now enters the visited router set, like so. I'll make all visited routers green once we're finished with them. Next, we have to repeat this process for those directly connected routers to A. So we'll examine routers B and D. Let's first look at router B. B is directly connected to A, D, and E. But remember, we're only looking at unvisited directly connected routers. So we ignore router A. The directly connected unvisited routers are E and D. To get to D, we have a total cost of 2, which is the cost to get to B, plus 5, which is the cost of this link here, which is 7. Remember, all of this is still being viewed from the point of view of router A, so we need that total cost. We take a look at our table here, and we see a value of 8 already in there for router D. But 7 is less than 8, so we update the table with a shorter path. Remember, shortest path first. So we put in a total cost of 7 and put the previous router as B this time, because that's the router through which we reach it, getting a cost of 7. Let's go on to see the other directly connected unvisited router, which is E. We have a cost of 2, which is our cost to get to B, plus 6 for a total of 8. Now look at the table. The previous entry was infinity, so we update that with the shorter cost of 8. And we put in B as the previous router because that cost is achieved via B. Now we are finished with B. There are no more directly connected unvisited nodes, so B now becomes a visited node. So we make B green. Next, we'll be looking at D. D has links to 4 routers, A, B, E, and F, but 2 of these, A and B, are already visited, so we ignore them. From D to E, the cost is the sum of 7, which was the shortest cost to D, plus 3, which is the cost of the link to E, for a total of 10. We take a look at the table and we see that E has a cost of 8 via B, which is actually smaller, so we don't change that. Then we look at the path to F. This is 7 plus 8, 15. In the table, the path to F is infinity, and 15 is definitely less than infinity, so we update the table. We put a value of 15 in the cost and D in the previous router column because the cost is achieved via router D. Now that we're finished with D, it too has become a visited node, like so. Then we take a look at the next unvisited node, which is E. From A via E, we can reach C with a cost of 8, the cost to get to E, plus 9, which is 17. So C now gets a value of 17 via E. And we also put E in the previous node column, as this cost is achieved via that router. Next, we take a look at the cost to reach F via E. The total cost is 8, which is the cost to get to E, plus 1, which is the cost of this link here, for a total of 9. In the table, to reach F, we already have a cost of 15 via D, but 9 is a smaller cost, so we replace that value of 15 with 9, like so. And we put E in the previous node column. Now that we're done with router E, let's mark it as visited and go on to router F. From router F, we look at all directly connected unvisited routers, and we only have one left, which is C. Now, to get to C from F, we have a total cost of 9, which is the cost to get to F, plus 3 to get to C via this link, for a total of 12. 12 is less than 17, which is already in the table, so we replace that value like so. And we put in router F as the previous router. Now that that's done, F becomes a visited node like so. Now, once we get to our last router of C, there are no more unvisited nodes that are directly connected, so it too automatically becomes a visited node. So the building of the shortest path first information within router A is complete. This table here is information that has been accumulated by router A about the topology and about the distances to reach each individual node. We have the shortest distance from A to every other node in the topology. And more accurately, we can say that we have the cost from A to every directly connected network on every one of these routers. So let's say we have this network here that's directly connected to router C. Looking at this table here, we can see from router A what the shortest path will be. Specifically, we have a cost of 12. But if we work backwards from C, we don't only have the cost, but we can also determine the full path to get there. How do we know that? Well, from C, to get this shortest cost of 12, we see that we have to go through F. To get to F, we have to go through E. To get to E, we have to go through B. And to get to B, we have to go through A. So the shortest path is A, B, E, F, C. When we look at a real OSPF router, the information found in this table is actually found within the link state database, or the LSDB. And this is why we say that OSPF, and in all link state routing protocols, each router builds a topology of the whole network. The distance to each router translates into the distances to reach all directly connected networks to all routers. Now, this here can be considered a single OSPF area. When we create multi-area networks, what we're actually doing is we're learning about the prefixes to those other areas, but we're not learning about the topologies found within those other areas. And this makes the LSDB much smaller and more manageable. And that's why creating a multi-area OSPF network is more efficient. So that, in a nutshell, is Dijkstra's algorithm and how it operates within the framework of OSPF. If you found this video useful, I would ask that you consider using the YouTube Super Thanks feature to say thank you and support my effort to simply explain telecom and networking. The funds will be used to support better equipment, better quality videos, better video editing services, and just to produce more useful training content. As always, I ask that you check out my website, where very soon you'll be able to find in-depth courses with labs, quizzes, and exams to test your knowledge and prepare you for certifications, as well as for the real-world networking and telecom industry. And don't forget to subscribe to the channel to get updates to newly published videos. I'm Lazarus at telecomTech. I hope this has been helpful for you, and I'd like to thank you for watching.